So this is a lecture on random matrices. So I want to give you some introduction into random matrices. Random matrices is a quite recent and quite active subject in mathematics. And this will be an introduction which should give you all the kind of flavors of the subject. Huh? Okay, so and maybe I start with a kind of introduction, which a little bit of history and maybe a little bit of things one is interested in. Well, what are random matrices and what are the questions one is going to ask and what interesting stuff is going to happen there. Okay, so it's a lecture on random matrices and we start with an introduction. And as usual, introduction, maybe we start with the history of the subject. Okay, so usually one says that maybe random matrices were introduced for the first time in statistics by Wishart. But actually a few years ago there was a paper by Diaconis and Forrester who claimed that actually already Hurwitz in 1897 had a paper which can be considered as the starting point of random matrices. So maybe that's the... And I mean, random matrices, essentially, it's integrating over high-dimensional spaces. And I mean, this was integrating over unitary groups. So in principle, these were random matrix questions in 1897. And maybe the paper was in German, Über die Erzeugung der Invarianten durch Integration. Okay, in any case, an interesting paper. But usually, maybe the starting point where random matrices really were introduced as random matrices maybe was by Wishart. So he was a statistician, so in 1928. And he introduced random matrices in statistics for describing correlations. Between statistical quantities, and he did this actually for fixed n. I mean, we are looking on random matrices; those are matrices of size n by n. But actually, usually, the interesting things happen if n goes to infinity. So here, n was fixed. So I mean, the idea you are measuring n things, and so you have an n by n matrix, and you are not changing n, but you want to know what happens for fixed n. Okay, so this was for fixed size. Good, but then not much was happening with this, and maybe in a sense the random matrices were reintroduced or introduced in a different context, namely in physics by Wigner, and this maybe is usually where the subject started off. So Wigner in 1955, introduced random matrices as a kind as of statistical models for describing atomic nucleus. I mean, they are very, it's very hard to make precise, rigorous statements, calculating anything about a nucleus. Maybe after the hydrogen atom, it's very hard to do concrete calculations. But if you want to make statistical descriptions, this is possible, or you can say something. And so he used or introduced random matrices as statistical models for describing atoms, for atomic nucleus. Okay, and he was also realizing that actually, if you send n to infinity, of course, if you have an atom which consists of n protons and neutrons, then of course you have a fixed n, and of course n is of the order maybe of a few hundred, but not more. But still, you observe that if you send n to infinity, then things are getting much more easier to describe, and there is a lot of interesting structure. So he studied this asymptotic n going to infinity And that is what we usually talk about, the large n limit in the random matrix. So the size of the matrix goes to infinity, and usually interesting things happen, and one can describe it much better than for finite n. Of course, the idea is finite n is not so far away from the limit. So the limit, of course, still tells you something about the finite n situation. So he studied, in particular, the asymptotics for n going to infinity. So usually these asymptotics usually goes under the name of large n limit in this subject. And he proved, let's say, the first basic theorem in random matrix theorem, which is Wigner semicircle law, which will also be something which we will try to understand and present in the first couple of lectures. Okay, then of course the matrices which Wishart considered were somehow a little bit different from those. I mean, there are different ensembles of random matrices. I mean, depending on how you specify your matrices. So the ones which Wigner introduced are now called Wigner matrices, and the ones which are used in statistics are usually called Wishart matrices. But Wishart didn't look on the limit n going to infinity, and this was actually done after Wigner by Marchenko and Pastour, who studied the limit of the Wishart matrices. And what you get there in the limit is usually called the Marchenko-Pastour distribution. So we will also talk about this. So this was also interesting result. So Marchenko and Pastour in 1967 looked on the asymptotics, which means n goes to infinity, of the Wishart matrices. So you see, it took a long time from 1928 to 67 to really answer this question. But essentially, this question was not asked before, at least not in statistics. Good. Okay, and then after this introduction in physics, random matrices became very popular in physics. So they were a very important tool for doing a lot of things. And so, I mean, they, in particular, in the context of quantum chaos, they were considered quite extensively, and universality questions in physics are all related with this. So in the, let's say, since the 1960s, so after Wigner introduced them, they became very popular in physics. So random matrices became important tools in physics for describing, I mean, many different situations. The idea is that you use random matrices for modeling interesting situations, and then, okay, you're asking questions, and those questions are also questions about random matrices, and in a random matrix context, you can sometimes answer them. And in particular, in the context of quantum chaos, which was very popular in the 70s, 80s, random matrices is very much related to this. Then also, universality questions in physics are very interesting. Universality means that results do not depend on the microscopic details. You are looking on a macroscopic quantity, which of course is given in terms of a microscopic model, but actually the microscopic details are not so important. And that's the universality. And in the context of random matrices, this also shows up very prominently. And so maybe apart from Wigner, the main, or let's say two main names in this context were Mehta and Dyson. And in particular, Mehta wrote, let's say, the first book on random matrices, which became very popular and was maybe the only book for a very long time. So Mehta had this book, which is called Random Matrices. And the first edition is from 1967. Okay, so this is the first book, and it was very influential, in particular in physics. Okay, in mathematics at this time, more or less nobody knew about random matrices. It was not really a topic. But then in the 70s, actually, it slowly moved into mathematics, and in particular because it was observed at this point that random matrices seem to have something to do with the Riemann zeta function. And of course, if something has anything to do with the Riemann zeta function, it's clear that mathematicians are interested in it. So around 1972, there was somehow more kind of observation that there seems to be a relation between the statistics of the eigenvalues of the random matrices, so relation between the statistics of the eigenvalues of random matrices, and that's actually what one usually is interested in random matrix theory, to look on the eigenvalues and understand their statistics. Okay, so it seems to be a relation between this on one side and the zeros of the Riemann zeta function. And the zeros of the Riemann zeta function. Okay, of course, the Riemann conjecture is that all the zeros are just lying on this one line, but here this is more about, so what is the statistics of the zeros on this line? It seems they have more or less the same statistics as the eigenvalues of random matrices. And this is a very surprising fact. And I mean, it's not, I mean, there are a lot of results in this direction, but it's not, still not totally well understood. Of course, the idea would be to use this for proving something about the Riemann zeta function. But at the moment, the status is more you observe that on the side of the Riemann zeta function, you have things which are similar to things which you have on the side of the random matrices, and then maybe you can prove things on the Riemann zeta side. But at the moment, of course, it would be much nicer if you could transfer results which you have on this side to the side of the Riemann zeta function. But I mean, there is no general principle for doing this at the moment. But still, there is maybe this idea or hope that at some point this can be done. Okay, and I mean, maybe this relation actually, this goes back to actually a discussion over T between Montgomery and Dyson, and really making a lot of numerical simulations. I mean, about the statistics of the zeros of the zeta function. This was done by Otlitzko, where you really have, I mean, the statistical behavior of millions of zeros of the zeta function. Good. Okay. And since then, it was clear that at least mathematicians also are interested in random matrices, and so maybe after a while there were more and more interesting things also going on in mathematics, and one can say maybe that, let's say, since the 1990s, random matrices really became also part of mathematics. And I mean, they became more and more a central part. And I mean, at the moment, they are really somehow a very active subject, which has a lot of connections to different things. So let's say, since the 1990s, the random matrices are studied more and more extensively also in mathematics. Okay, and I mean, there are many different things. It's not just this relation with the Riemann zeta function, but I mean, there are a few other very prominent things, and one is, for example, the distribution of the largest eigenvalue. I mean, these results of Wigner and this Marchenko-Pastour result is more about the average behavior of all the eigenvalues. Okay, but then there's also, you can also ask the question, what is the largest eigenvalue of a random matrix? Can one say something about its distribution? And this is what is now called Tracy-Widom distribution. So Tracy-Widom looked on this, and there's a famous result that you have a specific distribution there, which is now called Tracy and Widom. So this is the Tracy-Widom distribution of the largest eigenvalue of random matrices. And of course, we will also talk about this. Then there are relations with a subject which I'm working on, namely free probability theory, which a priori has had nothing to do with random matrices. But it was observed that actually there are relations to random matrices. So there's also a relation to this. And maybe at the very end of this course, I will indicate a little bit what this is, but so maybe now I just make also this connection. So free probability theory, which comes actually from the theory of operator algebras, functional analysis, which has absolutely nothing to do with random matrix a priori. After a while it was observed that, no, there are relations, and in particular connections to the Wigner semicircle law and such things. Then there have been results on universality of fluctuations. Again, universality of interesting quantities. Then maybe, in the last, maybe 10 years ago or so, there was a big hype on the circular law, which is a kind of non-self-adjoint version of the Wigner semicircle law. So the circular law is also a very popular question, which was more or less also answered in this context. And I mean, there are many more things. And I mean, they all describe interesting facets of random matrices. And so I mean, in this class, I will try to say more or less to touch all those things. Good. Okay. So I mean, that's maybe. What I want to say about the history. Of course, there have been many more specific results and so. But I mean, it doesn't mean much to you at the moment. So maybe we leave it with this, and then go a little bit more into what are actually random matrices and what do I want to know about them. Okay. But are there any questions about the history? Good. Then maybe I clean the board. And random matrices, I mean, are still very popular in physics. So good, but now maybe I should, if you're going to talk about random matrices, the first question is, of course, what is a random matrix? What do I mean with this? Of course, the name should be clear what it is. It is a matrix which is chosen in a random way. So let's say the question is, what is a random matrix? And of course, a random matrix is a matrix, so it has a given size, let's say n. It's a matrix A, where the entries are denoted by Aij. It's an n by n matrix. And of course, it's not a fixed matrix, but I'm choosing the entries in a random way. Or I'm looking on an ensemble where I have various possibilities for choosing the entries. And usually they are chosen in a random way, which means I want to ask probabilistic questions about random matrices. So where the entries Aij are chosen randomly. And very often I want a self-adjoint random matrix. Of course, it could also be a non-self-adjoint one, but usually I'm interested in the eigenvalues, and non-self-adjoint matrices, the question about eigenvalues is a little bit tricky. So if I have a self-adjoint random matrix, I can be sure that I have eigenvalues and I have enough of them. So usually the main, a lot of topic is about self-adjoint random matrices. And that's what we are going to do, at least for now. So often we require A to be self-adjoint. Good. Okay, now of course, I mean, to specify which random matrix I consider, I have of course to specify how do I choose the entries. And I mean, according to this choice, I have different ensembles of random matrices. And maybe the simplest, let me look on a very simple example, where for example, I only choose allow the entries to be plus and minus one. Okay. So this means I'm looking essentially now on all n by n matrices of all possibilities of the entries of being plus and minus one. And then I want to know something about, let's say, a typical or generic behavior of this. So here's the simple example, which is a discrete example. So I only look on a finite number of random matrices. Of course, in general, if I'm allowing continuous distributions for the Aij, there will be infinitely many. But maybe start with this very concrete example, so where I allow my entries of the matrix just to be either plus or minus one, and I can choose all of them independently. You know? So I mean, each of them can be, independent of all the others, be plus and minus one. So this means I'm considering all such matrices, consider all such matrices, and I'm asking now what is the typical behavior of this. Of course, I don't know to want precisely everything about all of those matrices, because that's just too complicated, but the randomness means I'm asking for averaged or typical behaviors. So I'm asking a kind of probabilistic questions. So what is the typical behavior which I see, what is the average behavior which I see among all those matrices. Okay, so consider all such matrices and ask for the typical or generic. Generic is just another name for typical behavior. Good. Okay, so in a more probabilistic language, this means I'm looking on my matrices as a probability space, and in this discrete space, all the matrices which I consider here have the same probability. It's just a finite number of matrices, and I want to ask probabilistic questions. Good, okay, so I have my matrices, but what do I want to know about them? Okay, in matrices, usually, matrices, the typical important quantity for matrices are the eigenvalues. I want to know what are their eigenvalues, because, I mean, if I use matrices for modeling something or describing something, then usually the eigenvalues are the important interest, or they answer a lot of questions about what I'm interested in. So the quantity of interest are the eigenvalues. So we are mainly interested the eigenvalues of the matrices. Okay, and I'm only looking on self-adjoint matrices. So if I have an n by n matrix, I have n eigenvalues if I count them with multiplicity. Good. Okay, so maybe, but yeah, of course. Of course, they have, such a matrix has n eigenvalues, but of course it depends on the actually chosen matrix. And the question is there anything interesting to say about this? So for this, let us consider this for small n. Okay, so let us consider this situation from above, where I'm choosing the matrices just with entries plus minus one. And of course, I'm choosing only symmetric matrices. So from above, with all the entries just being plus or minus one. And I'm looking on this for different size of the matrices. I told you in the beginning, it's usually the size n going to infinity where something interesting happens. But so maybe let us see, let us get some idea what actually is a good thing if n goes to infinity. Of course, if n is going to infinity, the matrix is getting bigger and bigger, and I have more and more eigenvalues, which looks it's getting more and more complicated. But still, there will be some nice behavior showing up in this limit. So for different size n of our matrices. Good, the smallest possible n, of course, is n equal to 1, a 1 by 1 matrix, which of course is very trivial. And in this case, of course, as my matrix, I have only two possibilities. So namely, either I have the matrix where the entry is 1, or I have the matrix where the entry is minus 1. And of course, the eigenvalues in this case, of course, here it is 1, and here it is minus 1. And so if I'm using a probabilistic language, this is my ensemble. Each of those matrices has the probability 1 half. So with probability 1 half, I have the eigenvalue 1. With probability 1 half, I have the eigenvalue minus 1. OK, that's OK, but not very exciting. So let us maybe look on n equal to 2. So then, of course, the complexity is getting more complicated. Then I have 2 by 2 matrices. And actually, I have 8 possibilities for those. So I'm choosing plus and minus ones, but I'm only looking on the symmetric ones. So for n equal to 2, I mean, I have 8 different matrices. I mean, and there will be some which are somehow very special. So now we have to see, of course, if I'm asking probabilistic questions, usually, I mean, there are many things which have small probability. And here, of course, there will be many matrices which have a lot of structure. And this means, of course, their eigenvalues will be special. And of course, a lot of structure, or what structure can we have? We can have that all the entries are the same. So for example, I mean, I have the matrix where I only have ones, or maybe I have the dual one where I only have minus ones. They, of course, are very special ones, and of course, the eigenvalues are also very special. So namely, here, the eigenvalue are 0 and 2, and here, of course, they are 0 and minus 2. Okay, and then, of course, we have other ones, like, for example, 1, 1, 1, minus 1, 1, minus 1, minus 1, 1, and so on. And, of course, they are still, I mean, for 2 by 2 matrices, of course, everything is special, but still, they are not as special as those. And they have, of course, only, they have also 2 eigenvalues. Maybe in this case, it's minus square root of 2, square root of 2, here it is 0 and 2, and so on. And all those matrices, of course, I have 8 of them, so we would say each of them has a probability of 1 over 8. And again, there's not much structure to see, so you would, with probability 1, 8, I have the eigenvalues 0, 2. Here I have them again with probability 1, 8, and I have some other eigenvalues. Okay, but this doesn't look so exciting, but the question is now, what happens if n is getting bigger? So for general n, of course, the number of matrices is increasing exponentially. So namely, for n, we have actually 2 to the n times n plus 1 over 2. So essentially, we can choose all the entries above the diagonal, because on the diagonal and above the diagonal, because below the diagonal, it must be symmetric. And so for each of them, we have 2 choices. So we have so many matrices. And then, of course, we say that each of those matrices has a probability 1 over 2 to this number. So if n is getting large, of course, each specific matrix has a very small probability. So one matrix doesn't count so much anymore. So each with probability 2 to the minus n times n plus 1 divided by 2. Good. And again, for any n, there are still very special matrices. For example, the ones where all entries are the same, either all 1 or all minus 1. Right? And they have very specific eigenvalues, and it's very easy to calculate them. Okay, but that's not the typical behavior. So, I mean, they show eigenvalues which are not typical, and if n is very large, they don't count. If we are interested in probabilistic behavior. So for all n, there are always these special ones. So there are always very special ones. So like the ones where all the entries are plus one. So for example, my matrix could be an n by n matrix, but all the entries are plus one. So this is a self-adjoint matrix, and the eigenvalues are also very easy to calculate. Actually, only eigenvalues of this is 0 and n. Okay, and 0 shows up with a quite high multiplicity. So namely, this has multiplicity n minus 1. So the eigenvalues of this are 0 and n. Okay, and this 0 here has a multiplicity n minus 1. Because, of course, I mean, the rank of this matrix is quite small. Good, and in the same way, if I have only minus ones everywhere, it's the same. It's then just that this n here is replaced by minus n. So on the other extreme, or the other side, I have the matrix where all the entries are minus one, and this has eigenvalues 0, and minus n. And again, the 0 is multiplicity n minus 1. Good, but those are very special matrices which show, in a sense, a very special behavior, and that's not the typical behavior in which we are interested. So what we want to know is what is a typical, or maybe even the average, or let's say the typical behavior of n by n matrices which are choosing in this way. And I mean, a typical behavior is not that we have multiplicities of the eigenvalues. But there will be some eigenvalues. Of course, I mean, there will be n eigenvalues. But the question is, can we say something about this? Okay, so I mean, first of all, those are not, I mean, we are not, I mean, this probabilistic approach means we are essentially ignoring such things. We don't want to know what those special matrices are doing, because otherwise we would have to control all eigenvalues of all matrices. That's, of course, not what we want. We only want to see specific features which you see in the majority of all matrices. So those are the guys which will not play any role. In particular, if n goes to infinity, they will be totally ignored. So they have small probabilities. And are atypical. That's not a typical behavior. And our question is, what is a typical behavior of matrices? So question what is the typical behavior of the eigenvalues? Good, okay. And I mean, if you're looking on those small examples, you might have the feeling there is no typical behavior. I mean, there will be n eigenvalues, but what else should one say? Okay, but now I will convince you, hopefully, that actually something nice is happening. And of course, I need a little bit bigger matrices, which I prepared on the computer. Where we are looking on different sizes of the matrices. Good, okay, that's not what I wanted. Good. Okay, so here I'm doing essentially again the same what I did here for the small ones. So let's say I'm looking on 8x8 matrices. Huh? Okay, I mean, there are already quite a bit of them. And again, there are the very special ones where all the entries are 1 and all the entries are minus 1. Huh? Okay, and of course, they have these very special eigenvalues. Huh? So namely, so this has 1 eigenvalue 8, and it 7 times it has the eigenvalue 0. And here, of course, it's the other way around, so minus 8 and 0. Those are very special situations and very special eigenvalues. But of course, that's not what we want, but what we want are more generic matrices, where I'm choosing essentially in a random way the entries among plus and minus 1. And I mean, of course, each of those matrices, again, has a very small probability, but now the question is, are there typical features which we see in most of them? Okay. But again, here with this 8, of course, there will now be 8 eigenvalues which are sitting somewhere. So those are the 8 eigenvalues, 1 here, 1 here, 1 here, and so on, of this matrix. And in the same way, this matrix has also 8 eigenvalues. At least we already see that typically we don't have multiplicities. So I mean, where I all have the ones, of course, they had multiplicities of the eigenvalues, which is very untypical. It's more typical that you don't see multiplicities, so you have different eigenvalues, but of course, they are just sitting somewhere. So I mean, it's not, I mean, of course, you could say here are 8 values, here are 8 values, but apart from this, it's not clear what else you could or should say. Good, but the point is that if we are making n bigger, then actually there will be more structure. So namely here, I have a 100x100 matrix, and I'm looking on the 100 eigenvalues of this guy, and I'm drawing the histogram. Then you see I'm getting something like this. So this tells me, I mean, I have, I don't know how many, a couple of eigenvalues sitting here, so many here, and so many here. So you see I get a kind of a shape, which already shows some structure. And the point is that if I'm taking another randomly chosen 100x100 matrix with plus and minus ones, I get an eigenvalue distribution which now looks quite close to the other one. So you see there is some structure emerging. So it seems that it, at least for large n, the typical eigenvalue distribution seems to be given by similar shapes. And if we are making n bigger and bigger, these shapes are getting closer and closer. So here I have a 3000x3000 matrix. Randomly generated distribution with plus minus 1 entries. So I have 3000 eigenvalues. This is the histogram of the eigenvalue. So now you see a very nice kind of shape of the eigenvalue distribution. And if you take another randomly chosen matrix, you see essentially the same picture. And this really shows you that there is actually a typical behavior of random matrices. Even though I'm choosing the random matrices in a random way, the eigenvalue distribution is not random anymore. It's always the same distribution. Apart, of course, from exceptional matrices. I still have here 3000x3000 matrices where all the entries are 1. And of course, they have a very different eigenvalue distribution. They have 2,999 zeros and 1,3000 as an eigenvalue, but that's not a typical behavior. If I'm choosing randomly 3,000x3,000 matrix, then I will see this deterministic eigenvalue distribution. Okay, and this is the main result. And of course, you see if n is getting very large, then this histogram approaches a very smooth curve. Namely this curve. And so what we are seeing here is essentially that the eigenvalue distribution of random matrices, at least the ones which we considered here, converges for n going to infinity to this shape, which is usually called a semicircle distribution. And because, I mean, this was really the result of Wigner to observe this and also prove this, so this is also called Wigner's semicircle. So that's one of the first and most basic results in random matrix theory. And this is something which we are going to understand in the next couple of lectures. That's one of the first things which we want to do, namely really to prove this. But that's somehow the feature of random matrices, which maybe if you see it for the first time is quite surprising. I mean, after a while you are used to everything and then nothing is so surprising anymore, but I still find it kind of surprising that you are creating a random matrix in a very random way. So your matrix is random, and you're asking a question of the eigenvalues, so the eigenvalue distribution should also be random. It should depend how you created the matrix, but actually it doesn't. You always get the same result. Okay, and that's something which you want to understand. Good, but now we go back to Blackboard. And we are trying, yeah. So maybe first, of course, we have to try to formulate what we have seen here. How do we capture this mathematically? And what do we really have to prove? And maybe I also say a few words about maybe universality in this context, and also about this kind of deterministic result, which are somehow the surprising features, and the features which makes the whole theory so interesting. Yeah, okay, so let me just state in words what we have seen in these pictures, namely this kind of Wigner semicircle law. So I mean, yeah, so at the moment it's just in informal words. Of course, we have to make this mathematically more precise, and we also have to prove it. So that's Wigner semicircle law. So that's what we saw in this pictures. So we see that typically the eigenvalue distribution of such a random matrix converges to a very specific deterministic distribution, which is this Wigner semicircle, or the semicircle distribution of such a random matrix, converges for large n. So if n goes to infinity, to Wigner's semicircle. Good, okay, and this is, of course, this is a statement about the global behavior of the eigenvalues. It's not about a single eigenvalue. We are not saying what happens with the largest eigenvalue, or we are not saying what happens with the eigenvalue number 17 counted from below, but it's just about the average behavior of the eigenvalues. So what is the limit shape of the average behavior? And maybe at this point, yeah, maybe you have the feeling, okay, I chose my entries plus minus one, so this was a very specific choice of my random matrices. And of course, you can think of much more, and you might think that what I get in the limit, the semicircle, really depends on what I have chosen as an input. But this is actually not the case. So you have a lot of freedom for making choices for the entries, and you still get the semicircle. And this is this phenomena of universality. So the macroscopic result, which are here the eigenvalue distribution, does not depend on the fine details of the microscopic input, which are here somehow how the entries are chosen. Of course, you must have, you cannot, it's not that for any matrix you get the semicircle, but you have big classes of matrices where this happens. So maybe let me make this result, or this statement about universality, because this is one of the interesting features in this context, and also in many contexts, maybe in mathematics, or in particular in physics, because in physics, of course, it's the idea, if you're describing a physical system on a macroscopic level by temperature and pressure and such things, then, I mean, of course, this comes from a microscopic model, but there are many microscopic models which, on a macroscopic level, give you the same. That's, of course, very important in physics, that microscopic details are not so important. And what you're looking on a macroscopic level, you have universality classes. And so it's, I mean, if small changes on a microscopic level would totally change the world, this would be quite catastrophic. Good, okay, so and we also have this CN random matrix theory. So this statement that you converge to the semicircle is valid, much more general. So namely, you can choose your entries also in a different way. So choose the Aij, not just as we did it up to now, not just from plus and minus one, plus minus one, which you can think of throwing a coin. So I mean, if you want to produce your matrix, you can throw a coin for each entry. And then accordingly, you put plus or minus one there. But maybe you can also throw a die and put 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 as an entry there. And so you could also do this. So instead of choosing the entries from plus and minus one, we could also choose them, let's say, from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, where you're rolling a die, to decide what you want to put as an entry in each of your entries. Or, of course, which is maybe the more usual canonical thing, you're choosing continuous distributions. And maybe the nicest distribution which you have in mathematics or statistics is the normal distribution, if you want to have a probability distribution. The Gaussian distribution or the normal distribution maybe is the nicest one. So later we will actually use these Gaussian matrices as the ones where we are proving things, because they have a nice structure where you can prove things. Calculating with plus and minus one is usually much harder than calculating with normal distributed quantities, because you they show a lot more structure. But anyhow, so at the moment I'm just saying that it doesn't really matter for the result what you get. So the Aij could also be normally, I mean, normal distribution is the Gauss distribution. Gauss distributed. And of course, this is a continuous distribution. Then, of course, we are looking not on a finite number of matrices, but we have infinitely many, and we are putting a probability measure on them for making our probabilistic statements. Or actually, instead of the Gauss distribution, you can take more or less any distribution you like. So you take any, you take your favorite distribution, but of course, you must say, what is the behavior, the relation between the different Aijs, and you choose them independently. So for each entry, you make a choice according a given distribution, but then you make this choice for any entry, but you do it independently. So like in this discrete case, you are throwing a coin for each of the entries. And the coin throw for the entry 2, 1 is independent of what you did before for the entry 1, 1. So for each of them, you throw again your coin. Okay, so the Aij could also be distributed according to your favorite distribution. You can take a Poisson distribution or anything you like. Okay, but of course, you still need some structure in this setting. So what is important actually is that the entries are independent. So independent, of course, apart from the symmetry condition. So I mean, if you choose something above the diagonal, you have to put exactly the same on the mirror image below the diagonal. But otherwise, all the choices you make are independent. Okay, and the point is that for all those matrices, we still have this Wigner semicircle. So the eigenvalue distribution of such a matrix for large n will typically be this semicircle distribution. So then we still have the same result, namely that the eigenvalue distribution converges typically to the semicircle. For n going to infinity. Huh? Okay, and I mean on the assignments here, this exercise one really, I mean, asks you in principle to produce random matrices or matrices in a random way on a computer algebra system. So maybe MATLAB is the one of our choice, and then also produce pictures like this. And then you can also, of course, play around and see if you're putting in other distribution for the entries that you still see the semicircle. Okay, so I mean the lectures will be mostly theoretically, but of course there's always these histograms and simulations in the background where you really see that really what you are proving is correct, or maybe you are getting ideas from the histograms. And you should also produce histograms for yourself. That's also part. So I mean there will be, from time to time, there will be assignments where you really should produce histograms. And compare it to what we are doing theoretically. In particular, this means you should, if you have never used MATLAB or anything like this, you should start to get familiar with it and install it and calculate eigenvalues of big matrices. Good. Okay. But maybe in then, so this is this universality which tells you that the result does not depend on the microscopic details, how we produce our matrices. But then there's still this other result, which maybe is even more surprising, that you get a deterministic answer for all your random matrices. And this is actually a kind of concentration phenomena, something which happens typically in high dimensions, and which, again, is something which you have never seen it before, is maybe counterintuitive what you're used from low dimensions, but it's a very important general feature which we see here concretely for the matrices. So maybe I also want now to say a few words about this, just that you get some idea that actually this, that you see one deterministic result is actually from a higher perspective, maybe not so surprising, because it fits into this concentration phenomena perspective. And in many, for many things, this concentration phenomena is important. I mean, there are various ways of saying this, but essentially it says that if the idea is that if you have a function of many variables, and no variable is dominant, then actually this function is more or less constant. So it does not really depend on the value of your variables. If you have many of them. And of course, this is very important for that things work, because I mean, it's a kind of stability. If you change a little bit your variables, not much is going to change. Good. Okay, but maybe another way of saying it is that in high dimensions, if you're looking on the ball of, let's say, of radius 1, then the mass of this ball is more or less sitting on the surface, or very close to the surface. Maybe that's a more intuitive way of seeing it. Which is something which is, you just can calculate. This is very easy to see, but maybe if you're looking on balls in small dimension, it's not what usually you see. So in high dimensions, the situation is quite different from low dimensions. So maybe let me say a word about this. So concentration phenomena. So this fact, which is I think a quite amazing fact, so that the random eigenvalue distribution, that the eigenvalue distribution, which a priori is a random distribution, so that the a priori random eigenvalue distribution of my matrices, the matrices are chosen in a random way, so the eigenvalues which I should see are also should also be a random distribution, that this a random eigenvalue distribution is for large n, or if n goes to infinity, not random anymore. So not random anymore, but it concentrates on essentially one deterministic distribution, namely the semicircle. So it's not random anymore. Concentrates on one deterministic distribution, in our case the semicircle, which is one, this is one distribution, this is not a, it's not a random object, but it's really a deterministic distribution, and this fact is actually an example of this general high dimensional phenomena of measure concentration. So this is an example of the general high dimensional phenomena of measure concentration. Which says in high dimensions, typical measures concentrate on very small sets. And in order to make this somehow, maybe not precise, but at least give a concrete example of this, let us look on the situation of a ball. So what happens with the volume of a ball? Where is most of the volume sitting? And so let me look on this example. So this is an example of such a concentration in high dimensions. And yeah, it is saying that in high dimensions, the volume of a ball is essentially sitting in the surface. So in high dimensions, the volume, I mean the volume here, I mean the Lebesgue measure, the Lebesgue measure of this ball. So the in the high dimensions, the volume of a ball is essentially sitting in the surface. Okay, this is a bit abstract, but I mean, in principle, you can calculate this because I mean, of course, we have formulas for calculating the volume of a ball. So, namely, if I take the volume, the Lebesgue measure of, let's say, a ball of radius r about the point zero. So I want to talk about the ball about point zero of radius r. So here's an r. So this is the ball of radius r about zero. And of course, I'm looking in r to the n. So maybe I should put also an n somewhere. Okay, but let me put an n here. So this is the ball in the dimension n. And of course, I want to know what happens if n is large. But of course, we have formulas for this. So we know that the volume of a ball is given by, in r it goes, of course, like r to the n. And then we have some constants, which are pi n over 2. And here we have n over 2 minus 1 factorial. Okay. Of course, if n is odd, then this is the gamma function interpolation for the factorials. So that's the usual formulas for for the ball. And so in particular, if I'm looking on a ball of radius 1, well, let's say I just want to fix the radius to be 1. So the ball of radius 1, of course, is pi to the n over 2 divided by n over 2 minus 1. Okay, so that's the volume, the back measure of the ball. And now I want to know where is most of the volume sitting. And okay, I'm claiming it's sitting in the surface. Of course, it's not strictly true that the volume is just in the surface, because the surface is a lower dimensional object which has the back measure 0. So what I mean with that it is essentially sitting in the surface is that it is sitting in an arbitrarily small neighborhood of the surface. So what I really want to look at is the set in R to the n, which is, let's say, up to an epsilon close to the surface. So those are the guys which have lengths between 1 minus epsilon and 1. So that's the guys which are up to epsilon close to the surface of the ball of radius 1. Just inside the ball. And what is the volume of this? And of course, I mean, this here, of course, this guy here, of course, is the ball of radius 1 minus the ball of radius 1 minus epsilon. And of course, we know the volume of both of them by this formula, so we can calculate the volume of this. So this is the volume of the ball of radius 1 in dimension n minus the volume of the ball, which has a little bit smaller radius, namely 1 minus epsilon. So the volume of B 1 minus epsilon in radius n. And of course we have this formula. So, I mean, we have this common factor. So this is pi to the n over 2 divided by n over 2 minus 1 factorial. And then I get here r to the n, which is just 1. And here I get this radius, so namely 1 minus epsilon to the n. And so this is the volume which is sitting close to the surface. And of course, I want to compare this to the volume of the ball itself. I mean, of course, this volume is not normalized here to be 1 for all n, but it increases with n. So I always have to take to consider the ratio. So I want to compare the volume of this, what is close to the surface, with the volume of the whole ball. So I'm just dividing this by the volume of the whole ball. And then, of course, you see that just this term here goes away. So this means if I'm comparing the volume of these elements which are close up to epsilon to the surface of the ball, so those are the axes whose length is between 1 minus epsilon and 1. If I compare the volume of this to the volume of the whole ball of radius 1, then I have to divide this by the volume of this, but the volume of this is just this factor here. So this just goes away, and I'm left with 1 minus epsilon to the n. And if I now fix epsilon and send n to infinity, which means I'm looking on bigger and bigger dimensions, then this here goes to 0. Which means the whole thing goes to 1, which means the ratio of what is close to the surface and what is all inside the ball goes to 1, which means more or less everything is close to the surface. Of course, it's important that I'm first fixing epsilon, dimension independent, and then send n to infinity. So first I say what means close, and then I'm changing the dimension. Of course, if this epsilon would depend in n, I could get different choices. But anyhow, so if I'm fixing epsilon, then this goes to 1 if n goes to infinity for any epsilon bigger than zero. Huh? So I can ask, I can be as close as I want. If I just go in dimension high enough, then more or less all the volume will be there. So this means in high dimensions, I mean in low dimensions, of course, this is not true. In particular, I mean in dimension one, my ball of radius one is just the interval from minus one to plus one. And then, of course, the volume is just nicely equally distributed over everything. Okay. Also in two dimensions, I mean, it is clear that the volume, I mean, is still nicely distributed. There's a lot of volume here. But in high dimensions, it's really, I'm taking a very small distance here. Then all, more or less, all the volume is sitting here. So almost all volume is sitting here in high dimensions. So if you see this for the first time, it looks counterintuitive because it's not what you are used to in low dimensions. But high dimension, I mean, high dimensions are really very high. And so we don't really have a good, there's a lot of space in high dimensions. But the most space is here. Good. Okay, and I mean this, so I mean, to compare this with the random matrices, I mean, you can say what we are doing here is, let's say we are choosing a random vector. So we are choosing just a point in the ball randomly, which means according to the Lebesgue measure, to the volume which we have on the ball. And then our question could be, what is the length of this vector? This would be like, what are the eigenvalues of our random matrix? Okay, and I mean, in low dimensions, of course, if I'm choosing a random point here, then its length will be constant, uniformly distributed between 0 and 1. So if I choose a point here, then the absolute value of it will be distributed between 0 and 1. And I mean, of course, it's not that most of them will have length 1, but it will be uniform distribution. But in high dimensions, so if I'm choosing a random vector in the ball, which means a random vector which has norm at most 1, then actually I can be in high dimensions quite sure that actually its norm is more or less 1, very close to 1. So this is somehow the same phenomena as for the random matrices. So I have a randomness here. I'm choosing randomly in this very big space my points, but then I'm asking a question which actually has an answer which is more or less deterministic. Good. Okay, so this hopefully gives you some idea, maybe, that, I mean, still, this phenomena is kind of amazing, but it's not totally crazy. It fits into this more general picture. Good. Okay, but now we also should go in the direction of formulating this convergence in a more rigorous mathematical way. I mean, if we want to prove this convergence of the histograms to the semicircle, the question is what really do we have to do for this? What does it really mean? So maybe we should rewrite what we have seen in the histograms in a more mathematical language. So that we get a statement which we then can also prove. Yeah. So what we have to do is somehow, from rewriting these histograms into maybe something which we can work better with, which are actually moments. So what I want to do now is to go from histograms. That's more or less the pictures which I showed you. To, let's say, moments, And this is something which we can better control and where we really can calculate things, and on this level we can prove more or less the semicircle. Good, but let us start from the histograms, because that's what we have seen. So maybe we should first try to formalize this. So let's say we have our matrix A, maybe, which I could also write A with a subscript n, because I mean things will depend on n, and our statements will be n goes to infinity. So An is now our matrix Aij, where I and j is running from 1 up to n. And of course the entries might also depend on n, but okay, I'm not writing it there, this should be understood. So A is our self-adjoint matrix, and let's say we are in this frame where we are choosing the entries plus minus 1 in a random way, in all possibilities. Self-adjoint matrix with Aij is equal to plus or minus 1 randomly chosen. So just to be specific. Good, and then what we have seen in our pictures, then we see that typically the eigenvalues of A and this we showed by histograms, so we looked how many eigenvalues do I have which are in small bins. So I mean we had these histograms where I had here my bins, which told me how many eigenvalues I have sitting there. I hope histograms are clear. So what I'm drawing here is, this height here gives me the ratio of the number of eigenvalues which I have sitting here. And so this picture here, for n to infinity, or for n large, is close to this picture of the semicircle. So this looks, for n large, somehow like this semicircle distribution. And maybe the semicircle I denote by mu w for mu Wigner, and this is actually a continuous distribution. I mean, of course, I have to do some normalization. Usually it lives from minus 2 to plus 2, but okay, it lives on a compact interval, and it has their density, which is like a square root function. So I have here a density times the Lebesgue measure. Okay, and I mean in the first assignment, you have to calculate something, in particular moments of this distribution. That will be a crucial thing. So of course we have to understand more things about this, and the first assignment will be quite a bit about this. Good, but now it's the question is what we see in this picture. What does this really mean mathematically? And mathematically, of course, so what am I saying? What does this have to do with this? Of course, what I'm doing here is that if I'm taking, let's say, here an interval from S to T, and here the corresponding interval from S to T, then I'm counting here the number of eigenvalues, which are between S and T, which are, of course, everything which I have here. And this is asymptotically the same as the number of eigenvalues, or the measure which I have here between S and T. So that this here converges to this, or is close to this, means that the number of eigenvalues which I'm finding here in, let's say, any interval S to T is close to this corresponding integral from S to T with this density. So this density here somehow should give me the density of the histograms here. So that's what it really means to see this here. So this convergence, which we are seeing here, means in this language, this convergence means that if I take the number of eigenvalues of my matrix in interval S to T, and I mean this has to be true for any interval, and of course I'm normalizing it now, because in the limit I want to have a probability measure. So I should here also take in a count in a probabilistic way, which means I have n eigenvalues, so I'm counting each eigenvalue with a 1 over n. Or I'm counting eigenvalues and then dividing it by n so that I get the ratio of the eigenvalues sitting here. So the ratio of the eigenvalues sitting here should go to the integral over this probability distribution. So the semicircle is a probability distribution, which actually you should also calculate in the first assignment. Good, okay, so we're dividing the number of eigenvalues in such an interval from s to t by n, and this for fixed s and t should converge if n goes to infinity to the integral from s to t over this semicircle, so over d mu w, and of course this guy has a density, so this is just the integral from s to t over this density pv x dx. So that's what, I mean, that's the mathematical way of saying what we see in the pictures. That's what we have to prove if we want to prove that the pictures are true. Good, but the problem is, I mean, this guy here, of course, is not so easy to calculate. This means we have to calculate how many eigenvalues do I have in the interval. In particular, this means I should know quite a bit about the eigenvalues. And of course, eigenvalues of matrices are not easy to calculate. So our matrices are given in terms of entries. We are saying, well, how do I generate my matrices? By putting in the entries. So on the entry level, I understand my matrices quite well. But of course, I'm asking the question about the eigenvalues. And eigenvalues are a very nonlinear function of the entries. So I mean, there is no nice way of going directly from the entries to the eigenvalues. So this means this here is an abstract quantity, which we don't really have direct access to. So this guy here, so this is difficult to calculate directly. But actually, maybe we can write this in a more conceptual way. But note that it is the same as a kind of averaging over a function, and of course over the counting function, the characteristic function. So maybe I'm writing it in a way which gives me possibilities of doing different things. So I'm writing it in a form that I'm taking 1 over n. This is of course just this n. And then the number of eigenvalues is just counting whether my eigenvalue is in this interval or not. Okay, so I'm looking how many eigenvalues do I have in this interval, but of course this means for each eigenvalue I should decide whether it is inside this or not, which means to each eigenvalue I apply the characteristic function of this interval. So I take here the characteristic function of this interval from s to t, and then I'm applying this to the eigenvalues, and the eigenvalues I'm denoting by lambda 1 up to lambda n of my matrix. So I have n eigenvalues counted with multiplicity. I denote them by lambda 1 up to lambda n, and I'm just writing it like this. Of course, this doesn't make the problem easier. It's just another way of writing it. So I'm not saying that this makes it anyhow better, but it's maybe a way which gives us more ideas. What we have to see is that actually this guy converges to this here. And of course, integrating from s to t, of course, also means I'm integrating over everything the characteristic function. So this means I'm writing this as the characteristic function, s to t of x, with respect to my semicircle measure. And now you see, I mean, essentially, I have to show that this sum over some function converges to the integral over the same function. Good. And maybe I should say, of course, the lambdas here are the eigenvalues. And of course, this 1 is the characteristic function of this interval. So maybe let me just write this down so that we are clear what I'm meaning here. So where, just to make the notation clear, with the lambdas, so lambda 1 up to lambda n, those are the eigenvalues of my matrix A. Huh? I mean, I have fixed here matrix A, and I want to see what is the behavior of the eigenvalues, and the eigenvalues I denote by lambda 1 up to lambda n, and of course I count them with multiplicity, and then I always have n of them, of A counted with multiplicity. Okay, and this 1 st, of course, is the characteristic function, so 1 st, this is the function, so of x, this is just 0 or 1, depending on whether x belongs to the interval or it does not belong. So it is 0 if x is not in the interval s to t, and it is 1 if x is in the interval s to t. So this means for each eigenvalue, I'm just checking, is it in the interval or not. If it is, I'm counting it as 1. Otherwise, I'm counting it as 0. And then this sum here, of course, gives me exactly the number of eigenvalues which are in the interval. Okay, and so what we see is in this language that actually we are claiming here, I mean, that's what we have to prove. At the moment, I'm just trying to write what we want to prove in a form that we will be able to prove it, or at least, I mean, even just have a statement. So the statement is that we have to show this here converges to this, and you see I have this here for the function, characteristic function, appearing here and here. So what I have here is actually the convergence of such a thing for specific functions which I have here. And so what we are claiming, hence, in star, we are claiming that actually this, and I mean I should have this for all s and t, not just for one interval, but for all of them. It should be true for all of them. So this means what I have here is 1 over n, the sum, and this characteristic function. I mean, this is now function f, which I should apply to my eigenvalues. And I have to see that for n to infinity, this converges to the corresponding integral over this function with respect to the semicircle. And here I have to see this for functions which are characteristic functions, for all f which are characteristic functions of intervals. Yeah, okay, and as I said before, these functions, okay, for these functions I have to check whether an eigenvalue is in an interval or not, which means I have to know where are the eigenvalues, which actually I don't, or it's very tough. So this means I still have the same problem. This is nothing which I can calculate easily, because for this I would really have to check where are the eigenvalues. Okay, but I have now written it in a form which suggests that maybe instead of looking to trying to prove this for those characteristic functions, maybe I could try to do it for some other functions. And then hopefully, by maybe more theoretical results, this will be the same as doing it like this. Because, I mean, in measure theory, you also know, I mean, integrating is doing integrating over measurable functions, but this is, if you know things about continuous functions, this is enough. So, I mean, if you know things for a sufficiently big class of functions, if you're doing integrals, this might extend to much more. So maybe we should not try to understand characteristic functions at the beginning, but maybe some other functions with which we can deal much easier. And actually, there is a class of functions for which things are much easier, and this is if I'm taking here monomials, powers of x, because then I'm just talking about moments here. That's what I mean with going from histogram moments, that actually I'm replacing the characteristic function by x to the n for all n. And for this, we have much better tools for proving things like this. So at the moment, I'm just saying that instead of looking on this problem,
we can replace this by another problem, which we can deal with easily. Okay, so let me finish with this. So I'm saying that actually this is hard to calculate directly. So at the moment we wouldn't know how to do it. Huh? So, but it is easier to calculate this for other functions f. And in particular, if I take for f just the power functions, then this is something which is much nicer. So in particular, for those of the form where f is not a characteristic function, but just x to the power n. And then, of course, this means then what I have to show, then I have what I'm calling, let's say, 2 star. So this is 1 over n, and then I take the sum from 1 to n, and now I take the power n to my eigenvalues, so this is lambda I to the n. This is on the left-hand side, and this has to converge for n to infinity to the integral over this function, which is now x to the n d mu w of x. Okay, and of course this here is now just the moment of this measure here, of this probability measure, which is of course also a quantity which one is used to deal with in probabilistic context. So what I have here, if I want this of course for all n, not just for one n, but in the same way as I want this here for all s and t, I want this here for all n. And this means here I have the moments of the semicircle, and what they are, of course it's so, it will be important to know what the moments of the semicircle are, and this is also addressed in one of the assignments. So we have to calculate the moments of the semicircle. And on this side, essentially, we have the average over the corresponding moments of the lambdas. Good. Okay, so I'm saying this is much easier, but of course it's not clear what it has to do with this here. Maybe this here is star. And actually, we will see later that this here, for all s and t, is more or less the same as this. Or if we are able to prove this for all n, then this will imply that this here is also true for all s and t by some more theoretical considerations. So this means it's good enough to prove this. And that's something which we can do more or less by hand or by without involving tools which we don't have at the moment. So, but of course it's important to see that this problem has something to do with this, because that's really what we want. That's what the histograms are showing us. So, but we will see that actually this here proves this. So, we will see later that in our case, the validity of this of star for all characteristic functions, that's what we really want, is equivalent to this for all power functions, so which is this here. So this is equivalent to 2 star for all n. Okay, I mean this is not obvious, this is not trivial, so we will at some point we have to talk about this, and but we have to develop tools for seeing this. But at the moment we just take this as given, because I mean we want to prove as quick as possible to the semicircle, because that's really the basic thing, but in this way it's okay, we cannot do it at the moment. But this is something which we can prove, or at least that's what we are now going to do in the next few lectures, or maybe next lecture, that we are proving this here for all n, of course. And of course, I still owe you, of course, why is this easier? So maybe it's also not so clear. Why is this quantity an easier quantity in the eigenvalues than this one for the characteristic functions? But so next time I will tell you why this is better, and then we go in the direction of really proving this. Good. Okay, so that's enough for today. Thank you.